Since we understood that a CMOS device has been fabricated by using NMOS and PMOS both, now we are going to design one application part of this CMOS, and in this application part we are going to view, or we are going to analyze a particular circuitry, and that circuitry is known as inverter. So first of all, I would like to give you the idea about how a CMOS inverter is constructed symbolically. Then we are going to see what is the operation of an inverter. Then we are going to connect those particular circuitry and the operation of inverter combinedly, and we are going to analyze how CMOS circuitry can be act as an inverter. So we are going to see how a CMOS circuitry can be constructed. First of all, we know that a CMOS is nothing but a PMOS and NMOS, both are going to connected, and in this CMOS we should know that the PMOS part of this CMOS, whose source terminal is connected with the highest potential. You should know this one. The source terminal of PMOS, or we have already seen that the source terminal of PMOS is connected with the higher potential, and the source terminal of NMOS is always connected with the lowest potential of the device. So according to that only, we are going to take first of all CMOS and the source, first of all PMOS, and the source terminal of PMOS is taken at the higher potential in the whole device structure. So I am going to draw that one. So I will take suppose this is a PMOS, this is the metal, this is the channel, and this is the symbolic representation, and we can see this is the PMOS device. How to recognize that this is the PMOS device? By this arrow. And we have, this is the gate terminal of this, and we can take, since the source terminal of PMOS is connected with higher potential, so we are connecting this one with VDD. This is the highest potential of this device, and this is the source terminal of PMOS, and this would be the gate terminal of PMOS, and this is the drain terminal of PMOS. If you observe my previous lecture, just before this present lecture, we have seen that the drain terminal of both PMOS and NMOS are close to each other. If the drain terminal of both PMOS and NMOS are connected to each close to each other, we must connected the drain terminal of both the device. So again we are having this particular device like this, and we are taking, this is the line which is representing an arrow, this arrow again representing that this is NMOS, and the source terminal of NMOS, this is source, and this is the source, this arrow representing the source, and the source terminal of NMOS, and this is the gate terminal of NMOS, this is the drain terminal of NMOS, this is N, this is N, this is N, and the source terminal of NMOS is at lowest potential, so it has been grounded. So this particular series connection of this PMOS and NMOS, which is nothing but the CMOS, this is PMOS, and we have taken this is NMOS. How to recognize that this is PMOS? By this arrowhead. How to recognize that this is of NMOS? By this arrowhead. And we are going to create an inverter. Inverter means, for getting an inverter, you should make the whole circuitry would have only one input, and the whole circuitry would have only one output. This is the output terminal, this is the input terminal. So I am representing this input terminal with VI, the voltage input, and I am representing the output terminal of V0, the voltage output. So we are observing, we are going to see this particular circuit diagram which we have drawn just now will act as an inverter. So I want to observe the operation of inverter first. So what is an operation of an inverter circuit? Operation of inverter circuit. Then we will like to see how this particular CMOS can act. This particular structure is nothing but the circuit diagram for a CMOS inverter. CMOS inverter. And I am taking the introduction part of CMOS inverter first. So operation of an inverter, what is an operation of an inverter? Inverter means if you apply a logic zero, I am telling first of all in terms of digital inputs. So I would like to say that if you apply a logic zero at the input of any device and we are getting the output as a logic one, then I can say that the operation has been inverted. So this is the input, this is the input, and this is the output. So similarly, in vice versa, that means if we apply logic zero, logic zero, logic one, of course it is logic one, logic one at the input of this particular device, any inverter device, and we are getting logic zero at the output of any particular device. If we apply logic one, we are getting logic zero. If we are applying logic zero, we are going to get logic one. Then the operation is said to be, it has been inverted. So this is nothing but the inverter operation. This is nothing but the inverter operation. So if in terms of signal also, we can understood these things. So how to understood these terms in signal formation? This is the signal. So if I apply, suppose a low voltage at the input of this device, and we are getting a high voltage at the output of the device, and if you apply a high voltage in the input of the device, and we are going to get a low voltage at the output of the device, then we can say this is a inverter operation. So I will like to say this is low, logic low, this is high, this is high, and at the output we are getting, first of all we are getting high, and after that one we are getting low. So the time period that it will take for this particular signal to complete one operation, that is low to high, is, suppose this is the total time period, and at T by 2 the operation will get changed from low to high. So we are getting the similar thing here. The whole operation from this point to this point is nothing but taking the time total T, capital T, and this particular point is observed to be T by 2. So the signal has been inverted here. This particular operation is known as inverter operation. So I will like to make a particular circuit which is known as CMOS circuitry, and how it is acting as a as an inverter, we can observe it by using this input and output. So I would like to say that if we apply a low signal, we are getting a high signal here, and if after particular time we are applying a high signal here, we are going to get a low signal at the output of this device. And we should observe the time period also. At T by 2 we are going to change from low to high, and at this similar time, the total time period from this point to this point is nothing but total time period T. And here also we are having this point to this point, this particular time period is nothing but T, and at T by 2 the operation has been changed. If it is changing from low to high, your output will change from high to low. So this particular operation is known as the inverter operation. Okay, so I think you understood that what is an inverter. Inverter is nothing but a circuit. Here the CMOS is the circuit, and in this circuit, if at the input of this circuit, if you apply a low voltage, we are getting a high voltage at the output, and if at the input we are applying a high voltage, we are getting a low voltage at the output. So I would like to say this is high first, and we are getting a low at the second. So this is the inverter operation. So we are going to analyze these things by using this CMOS circuit, and when we are going to observe how this CMOS is acting as an inverter, I would say first of all we will analyze the transfer characteristic of this particular device. So what will be the transfer characteristic? The transfer characteristic is nothing but the relationship between transfer word, whenever it comes, it gives the relationship between input and output. That means we are going to draw the voltage transfer characteristic first. So observe, in my next video I will give you the voltage transfer characteristic of this particular inverter device. So in this lecture, students, we are going to observe first what will be the transfer characteristic, and in the next lecture we are going to find out how to get this transfer characteristic. So this is a CMOS circuitry. In this CMOS circuitry, we have already seen that this CMOS is acting as an inverter. When we apply the signal at this particular terminal, which is known to be the input terminal, which is the same potential that we are going to apply at the gate terminal of PMOS and NMOS simultaneously, and from the drain terminal of both the device, we have taken the output, then the output is the inverted form of input, is nothing but the inverter operation. So what is output is the inverted form of input means, in terms of the voltage, if you observe here, if you apply it, the input voltage is equal to zero, that is the lowest possible value of this device, because the lowest possible value is nothing but the value at which the source terminal of NMOS is connected. Here the source terminal of NMOS is connected to ground, that's why it is at zero voltage, because the source terminal of NMOS should be connected to the lowest possible value of the whole device, So if you observe the whole device, the source terminal is at potential zero, and there is no other terminals which should be connected with zero, otherwise the magnitude of current would be equal to zero. That means the whole device, in the whole device, the source terminal should be connected with zero volt. And the other potential that we are going to see here, this is VDD, and this VDD should be connected to the highest potential of this whole device. And suppose I am taking that this the highest potential that can be applied, that I am applying in this device, is nothing but the 5 volt. So we can observe that the source terminal of PMOS is connected to 5 volt, and the source terminal of NMOS is connected with 0 volt, then whatever voltage we are applying at the input terminal of the device should be in between 0 and the 5 volt. If you are talking about a continuous signal, that means if you are telling that the low voltage has to be applied here, in terms of voltage, I would like to say the low voltage is nothing but the 0 volt. And if you are applying the high voltage, in terms of the voltage of this particular device, in which the highest potential should be applied to the source terminal of PMOS, and we know that the source terminal is PMOS is connected to 5 volt, then I would say that we are applying a 5 volt. So in between these two voltage, we can apply any other intermediate voltage values, but the lowest possible value is 0 volt for this device that I am using, and the highest possible value of this device is 5 volt that I am using. So if we apply a 0 volt at the input, we are getting the 5 volt at the output. If we apply a 5 volt at the input, we are getting a 0 volt at the output. This is nothing but the relationship between input and output voltages, and that what I say, that what is nothing but the transfer characteristic of voltage. That means the voltage transfer characteristic, which is also known to be VTC, that is voltage transfer characteristic. So I have drawn the voltage transfer characteristic of CMOS inverter. So observe this carefully first, because in the next few lectures we are going to analyze, analytically we are going to analyze, this is the graphical plot, analytically, that means we are taking some values and we are going to get this graph again by observing or by getting the points at which we are distinguishes the characteristic or the voltage transfer characteristic of the device. Now observe this one, this is a voltage transfer characteristic. So first of all, I will give you the idea that if we apply a 0 volt at the input of the device, we should get the output of the device should be at highest potential. This is high. So this is the inverter operation. See, this x-axis is nothing but the input. So this particular origin is nothing but zero. That means the input voltage that is applied at this corner or origin is nothing but zero. At this condition, this y-axis is nothing but V naught. We have the output voltage when we apply zero should be at this line. See, this is at VDD. We are getting VDD at the output. And if you talk about the potential is nothing but 5 volt. Similarly, the last point, if we apply a maximum value, that is VDD, at the input of this device, we are not getting any y-axis. That means the potential that we are getting at output is nothing but the 0 volt. So these are the two points which is showing the logic operation of this inverter circuitry. But if there is a continuous signal between 0 and 5 volt, and if you want to find out what are the values of all the range of voltages between 0 to 5 volt, we have to draw this transfer characteristic. So I have drawn this transfer characteristic by the reason that I know how to get this transfer characteristic, and I will tell you how to get this transfer characteristic. But before, you should get the knowledge of how to get the transfer characteristic. I urge you that you should observe the transfer characteristic first and divide this transfer characteristic into different segments, so that you should know what are the operations that we are getting at different segments of this transfer characteristic. Then we are going to see how to get those operations analytically in the further lectures. So I have divided this transfer characteristic into different segments. We can observe that we have different dots, and at these dots we are going to observe that what are the operations of this PMOS and NMOS at different segments of this transfer characteristic. Segment means I have divided this particular transfer characteristic into different small segments. So suppose this is the first segment and this is the second segment. You should draw a vertical line between this and this, and we can take this is the third segment we can have, and this is the fourth segment. This is the fourth segment. So I have divided this transfer characteristic into different segments so that we can do the analysis of each and every segments individually. So the first segment, if you are talking about, I want to know in which regions your PMOS is operating in the first segment, and in which region the NMOS is operating. You should by heart this particular segment's operation, because in the further lectures we are going to find out how we are getting different region of operation of this PMOS and NMOS analytically. So I will use the one particular letter from this PMOS, that is P, and one letter from the NMOS, that is N, and I would like to write in which region this PMOS is operating in first segment. So I would like to name these segments also. Suppose this is A and this is B point, this is C, and this is we can say this is C dash. So this is C and this is C dash, this is D and this is E. So if you observe, we have taken 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7 points. In between these 7 points, we have taken A, B, C, C dash, D and D. Total 6 letters to represent different points. And we have another points which doesn't given by any letters, but this particular point is also important here. And we have, if you observe this one, this is a vertical line which is connecting, direct vertical line which is connecting this C and C dash. So you should draw this diagram carefully in your notebook first. After writing in which regions your PMOS and NMOS are working in different segments, you should draw this particular diagram properly, and you should write what will be the operation regions of PMOS and NMOS in different segments. And when we find out the operation regions analytically, if the regions of operation that we have going to find out analytically matches with what we have written in this particular segment, you should just tick mark those particular segment. Okay, we are going to do this one, and you should follow me while doing this one. So I am writing here PMOS, here PMOS and NMOS operation. The NMOS is working in cutoff region. NMOS is working in cutoff region in this particular region from A to B, and PMOS is working in linear region. This is the first region of operation. And in the second region of operation, if you observe this one, what is PMOS and NMOS region of operation? In the second region of operation, your PMOS is working in linear only, there is no change. But your NMOS is working in a saturation region of operation, in between B and C. In the third region, where again we are writing this is PMOS and NMOS, your PMOS is working in this particular region, it is linear really, then it moves up to the saturation region of operation. And your NMOS, which is working in saturation region of operation, is continuing with this saturation region of operation in this region on also. And after this first, second and third segment, we have to observe what will be the operation of this fourth segment. This is the fourth segment. In this fourth segment, we can observe that your PMOS is in cutoff region of operation. Your PMOS is in cutoff region of operation. And your NMOS is in linear region of operation. This would be in linear region of operation. So these are the four segments in which we have observed. This is linear region of operation. I have changed the color of the pen. These are the region of operation. That means if you observe one by one, first of all this part and this part. In this part your PMOS is working in linear and this one is saturation. In this particular point, this PMOS and NMOS, in this particular point it is working in, PMOS is in saturation, NMOS is in saturation. So I would like to change the position. So this particular point, at this particular point, your PMOS is working in saturation and your NMOS is also working in saturation. Same thing, but I have slightly changed the position. And now this is the particular point which does not have any name. Now I am talking about C dash and D. After both are working in saturation, we are again writing this particular C dash and E. What is the operation region of PMOS and NMOS? So in this region, your PMOS, which is working linear in this region, would be shifted to saturation in this region. Your NMOS, which is working in saturation, it has to be shifted to a linear region of operation. So totally we have 1, 2, 3, then 4, then 5. So we have 5 region of operations, different region of operation at different particular segments. But at this particular point, which does not have any name, and the vertical line here, we should know that your PMOS is in saturation and NMOS should be in saturation. This particular point, which does not having any name right now, is known as, this particular point is known as logic threshold. This particular point is known as logic threshold of the CMOS inverter. So observe this one. This particular point is known as logic threshold, which does not have any name. If you name this one A, B, C, C dash, this is known as logic threshold. Threshold of CMOS inverter, of CMOS inverter. So what is this logic threshold? Why we are naming this particular point as logic threshold? The reason is that if you observe this one, many times we are saying this one as switching threshold. So we can also known as this one as switching threshold. We can now connect this switching word from the operation of this one. If you observe this point carefully,
at this point, before this point, we can have the PMOS is in linear, NMOS is in saturation. And after this point, we are observing that PMOS is in saturation, NMOS is in linear. That means this point will divide two devices, that is PMOS and NMOS. This point will divide these two devices and change these two devices the region of operation. It will change the region of operation these two devices,
and both the devices or region of operation has been changed at this particular point. That's why it is called the switching threshold of CMOS inverter. So if you observe this one here, before this point here, we have the PMOS is in working in linear and NMOS is in saturation. Now see, after this point, how it is getting changed. PMOS, which was working in linear, now it is working in saturation. NMOS, which is working in saturation, now it is working in linear. That's why this particular point is called switching threshold of CMOS inverter or logic switching threshold of CMOS inverter. Because at this particular point, the operation of the device, the region of operation of the PMOS and NMOS device has been interchanged. The PMOS, which is working in linear, now moved into saturation. The NMOS, which is working in saturation, is now moved into linear. So this is the region of operations of different particular segments of the devices. So you should by heart this operation regions and this particular diagram, so that you can connect when we analyze this particular device by taking some values of every point of the input and output. We are going to analytically find out what will be the region of operation of this particular segment, this segment, this segment, this segment, every point we are going to find out. But why I am telling that you should by heart this particular characteristic and region of operation, the reason is that while sitting in an exam, in gate exam, we are not going to find what is the analytical way to get any particular point voltage by using the values of this particular device. We are directly switch on to a particular value and tell in which region of operation your PMOS and NMOS is working. So that's why I am telling this. So for getting each and every points, we shall write the points that we are observing here. This is at zero. This is the threshold voltage of an NMOS. And this particular value, which is going to be at the center of this 0 and VDD, is known as VDD divided by 2. That means at any points we can find out what is the region of operation. So if we have someone ask at VDD by 2 of input, what is the region of operation of PMOS and NMOS, we can directly see both the device is working in saturation. And after this one here, at this particular point, we are having VDD minus mod of VTP. This is the point. So if you know, if you take, observe carefully, if you take VTN is equal to mod of VTP is equal to 1 volt, the practical value, and we have known that VDD is equal to 5 volt, then we can write each and every values here. So that's why I am telling you that you should just by heart this particular characteristic. So I can say that this is at 0 volt and this is at 1 volt, this is at 2.5 volt. And here we are having, this is VDD minus mod of VTP. So we can know that, we know that this VDD is equal to 5 volt, 5 minus 1, that is equal to 4 volt. And after last one, we are having this is equal to 5 volt. That means you have divided the operation of an inverter in this particular voltage range, 0 to 1 volt first, then 1 to 2.5 volt. We are going to observe what will be the region of operations. And then 2.5 to 3 volt, we are going to observe what is the region of operation of both the devices. And then 4 to 5 volt, we are going to observe what is the region of operation of both the devices. Similarly, according to this, we are going to take different segments in vertical lines also. We are going to take what is this particular value, what is this particular value, what is this particular value. So, starting from top to bottom in vertical line, we have this particular point is written by, this is VDD by 2 and plus of mod of VTP. That means this is 2.5 plus VTP is equal to 1 volt. That means this particular point is observed to be 3.5 volt. Then this particular point, which is VDD, is nothing but 5 volt. Again, we are taking this particular point, which is VDD by 2. So VDD by 2 correspond to x axis is nothing but VDD by 2 in corresponding y axis. And this is observed to be 2.5 volt here. And now here we can write this is nothing but VDD by 2. Similarly, this point minus VTN. And VDD by 2 minus VTN means, since VDD is equal to 5 volt, we have already taken. And 2 means 2.5 volt. And minus VTN, that means 1 volt, VTN is equal to 1 volt, then this particular point is nothing but which particular voltage? This is 1.5 volt. So if you moving down 5 volt, then 3.5 volt, then 2.5 volt, then 1.5 volt, then at last we are having 0 volt. So just I know each and every points of this particular graph. So we are going to analyze this particular graph by taking values in this particular range of inputs, and we are going to find out whether we are getting this range of outputs and whether we are getting this particular operations of this CMOS inverter or not. So whenever we are getting a particular operation or particular output according to this input, then we are going to tick mark those particular region of operation and those particular output in this graph. But you should remember, all these things had to be by heart by yourself, and it will help you to solve a question in few seconds in gate exams. Okay, thank you. Okay, student, I think you did your work. What is your work? You should have to by heart this transfer characteristic, and you should know that at each and every input values that we are applying in this CMOS inverter, whether you are getting this particular output values or not, and if you are applying a particular range of input voltage in this CMOS inverter, then whether we are getting the operation regions of PMOS and NMOS correctly or not, this is your work now. So here I am going to find out, if you are applying input voltage that is equal to 0, that is if you are working at point A, then whether you are getting VDD at the output or not, or whether we are getting the NMOS and PMOS region of operation same or not, this is the first things that we are going to do. And second thing that we are going to do in this particular point only is, we are going to apply 0 to VTN a range of voltage, that is we are going to apply a 0 to VTN at the input, and its working range is A to B, and in this range also we are going to find out whether we are getting the output VDD or not, and the operations of this PMOS and NMOS is matching with our analysis or not. So this is the circuit diagram. We should have to analyze the circuit diagram first. And you should have to know what is the cutoff region and what is the linear region, what is the saturation region, everything. So first of all, I am going to analyze this circuitry. Then I will tell you what are the region of operations, and according to the voltage, how to determine the region of operations. So I am applying a 0 voltage the input. So how this 0 volt is acting on this CMOS, NMOS and PMOS, we should have to analyze this one first. So if I am applying a input voltage which is equal to 0 volt, so this 0 volt, how this 0 volt is applied to this NMOS first, we know that the input voltage which is equal to 0 volt is nothing but the voltage difference between gate and source terminal. See here, this is connected to this, there is no resistance here. That means VI is equal to the same voltage that is applied to the gate terminal. Or I can say this VI is nothing but the voltage difference between gate and source. The reason is that the source terminal is grounded and the voltage at the source terminal is 0 volt. So if you know the things, that is this input voltage is nothing but the voltage applied at the NMOS gate terminal. The reason is that VI can also be written as VGSN. And if you know the source terminal of NMOS is at 0, I would like to write this is VGN minus VSN. And we can say that this is nothing but the VGN, because the source terminal is connected to 0. So whenever I am applying any potential, you should remember these things also. whenever I am applying any potential at this input terminal, the same potential has been applied to the gate terminal of NMOS. So this is the gate potential. This is the gate potential of potential of I will drive to right here. This is the NMOS potential. The first thing is that, and second is we are going to see in this direction also, in this direction. So what is in this direction? We are going to apply some potential at the gate terminal of PMOS also, because these two terminal has in no resistance. So whatever potential we are applying at this particular terminal is applied at the gate terminal, but the source terminal of PMOS is connected to 5 volt. So if we are writing the same thing for PMOS, so for PMOS, for PMOS I am writing that what is VGSP. VGSP is nothing but BGP minus BSP. So since the BGP potential is nothing but VI potential and BSP is nothing but the 5 volt potential, we can observe there. This is BSP which is connected to VDD. So we can write this is VGSP is nothing but input potential minus 5 volt. So if we apply an input potential of 0 volt, this is 0. Then the gate potential of S, gate potential of PMOS, gate potential of PMOS, this is 0 minus this is 5 volt. Then we can observe that VGSP of PMOS, VGSP of PMOS is equal to minus 5 volt. So from here we can observe that when we apply the input potential is equal to 0, the VGSN is nothing but VGN and VGN is equal to VI. That means VGSN is equal to VI for the NMOS, and VGSP is equal to minus 5 volt for PMOS. This is the difference. This is the direct difference that we can observe. So we can write here we can write this is VGSP for 0 volt of input. VGSP is equal to minus of 5 volt, and this is VGSN is it, this is equal to the input voltage and this would be equal to 0 volt. So here it is acting differently, here it is acting differently. And now we are going to find out what will be the output and what is the region of operation of PMOS and NMOS. So first of all, if you are working in any region of operation, I will tell you the steps how to analyze. First the step is step 1, any range of operation, step 1 is that you should find out whether the particular MOS, that is either NMOS and PMOS, it is cutoff region, it is working in cutoff or it is working in on region. So that means we should have to find out. First thing is that on or off of a particular device. So this on and off is divided into two parts. Why? Because we have two devices. This is NMOS is on or off, or PMOS is on or off. These things has to be find out first. So for how to find out NMOS is on or off, for getting the NMOS is on or off, NMOS will be on when the gate terminal voltage is greater than the threshold voltage. So if the gate terminal voltage of NMOS is greater than threshold voltage of NMOS, then only it will get on. And similarly, if you want that the PMOS should be on, then we should write the gate terminal voltage of PMOS. The gate terminal voltage of PMOS should be greater than the mod of the threshold voltage of PMOS. This has to be done, otherwise we cannot find out whether it is on or off. Okay.